introduce Corby Kammer, Harold McGee, and Maestro Ferran Adria, Bill Buford.
I think there's two ways to approach Ferran Adria, as a god and as a mortal. As a god, he's the person that Alain Ducasse described the greatest chef on the planet. As a mortal, he's just a guy in the kitchen. But first, I wanted to make a few random observations about my first meal at El Bulli. The meat course was course 35, and it consisted of three baby pigtails, beautifully crisp, beautifully fried on the side of the plate. Sweet things like chocolate were savory, savory things like beets were sweet, and everything was all confused until we got a Szechuan button, which electrified our tongues, and we were all utterly in this man's power. Tonight, Ferran Adria is going to be questioned and interrogated by two of our most formidable writers of food. Corby Kammer, who's a great advocate of slow food, and Harold McGee, who is the smartest man on food alive. McGee, it is my privilege to introduce possibly the greatest chef ever, Ferran Adria, God.
Del taller todo el mundo habla y casi, es decir, en el del bulli casi mucha gente habla y no ha estado casi nadie.
A lot of people talk about the bulli, but very few people have actually been.
Del taller del bulli hay un mito bastante equivocado.
As far as the taller, the workshop, there's a bigger myth.
La gente igual se puede imaginar que hay probetas y cosas allá, aparatos raros.
People may think it's like a proper science lab, you know, with testing tubes and the likes.
Para nada.
And it's not at all like that.
Hay cocineros,
there are chefs, cooks,
cuchillos,
knives,
y mucha, mucha pasión por la creatividad.
And with a very great passion for creativity.
¿Y cómo empezamos?
So where do we start? How do we do it?
Empezamos una silla, una mesa.
Started off with just a table and a chair.
Y 20 libros.
And 20 books.
You stopped serving bread because you said that anyone can get bread any place else in the world. They have to come here for what only I can give them.
No, yo me doy cuenta un momento en mi trayectoria.
I realized at a very certain moment in my career
que hay algo que no funciona en los restaurantes.
That something wasn't working in restaurants.
Sobre todo en restaurantes de cocina de vanguardia, de cocina
especially
de
avant-garde restaurants.
Cuando si ahora voy a casa de Harold.
If I go to Harold's home.
No tengo carta, no hay una carta allí.
I don't get a menu.
No, me sentaré en la mesa.
I'll sit at his table.
Harold me hará la cocina que él quiera.
And Harold will cook whatever he pleases.
No hay una carta donde me pueda decir, Harold, por favor, ¿me puedes traer una ensalada de tal?
I can't ask Harold, hey, can I get this salad?
¿Cómo es posible que en un restaurante de cocina vanguardia pueda haber una carta?
So I thought, oh, how is it possible that an avant-garde restaurant should have a menu?
But you know, it was 35 dishes and there's no menu. Because the whole idea is you're constantly surprised, you're constantly taken off balance. And there would be no point in having a menu because it's all new experiences you've never had before.
But the first thing that hits you is just how beautiful the dishes are. And then they're delicious. There were dishes that I was puzzled by. I really had no idea how they were done. The second time I ate there, I actually ate at the kitchen table, and Ferran was there to explain how things were done, if we wanted to know. The one that came to my mind is actually something that was very simple, but completely inexplicable, and that was a cup of coconut. Tasted like the most intense coconut I've ever had. When you're presented with something on the plate, you don't say, oh man, that must have been done in a vacuum dehydrator. How interesting. It's, that's the best piece of coconut I've ever had in my life. Well, cooks are now pushing the limits of what they do and know so much that they're actually creating new areas for scientists to work in because we don't really know what's going on when, for example, you cook an egg at 63 degrees Celsius for 24 hours. Scientists can't tell you what the proteins are doing to give you the kind of creamy texture that you get in the white. Sous vide cooking, that involves cooking meat for maybe 2 or 3 days at relatively low temperatures, but it has a texture like nothing you've ever had before.
Which is the goal, to make people experience food in a way they haven't before. But Ferran, do you want people to know what they're eating?
Saber de comer es muy difícil.
To know about food and eating is a rather difficult task.
Muy difícil.
A really difficult one.
Imposible.
Impossible.
¿Cuántos tipos de zanahoria hay en el mundo?
How many different types of carrots are there?
Multiplica esto por todos los productos que hay en el mundo.
Multiply that by all the different ingredients available in the world.
Y te darás cuenta que no puedes saber.
And you realize you just can't know, you won't have the knowledge.
Es muy difícil entender una comida en el bulli.
And it's rather difficult to understand a meal at the bulli.
Como es muy difícil entender un amanecer.
Like it's very difficult to understand a sunrise.
No se entiende.
You don't understand.
Lo disfrutas y ya está.
You just enjoy it.
Tell us something you've eaten in New York that you were interested in.
Hoy hemos ido, ¿cómo se llama? El Calz, ¿no? José Andrés. Calz.
Oh, yes, we went to Katz Delicatessen this morning.
It's clear to me how driven Ferran's cooking is, not by science, but by the need to make new things, and also by the need to understand how those things are made and to understand the process by which they're made.
Porque yo no soñaba, nosotros no soñábamos en nuestra vida.
Because we never expected
crear lo que hemos creado.
To create what we have ended up creating.
No, al final yo la gente come lo que a mí me gusta comer.
In the end, people eat what I like eating.
Es algo tan sencillo como esto.
It's as simple as that.